Hi, my name is Paula Jackson. I'm with Vermont Rural Water Association, and today we're going to be walking through the steps to shock chlorinate your well.
The procedure demonstrated in this video can be used by public water systems as well as private wells.
So we need to talk about why you would need to shock your well. And there's a couple of reasons. One of the biggest reasons would be if there was contamination that caused health effects for your consumers. Contamination of that sort would be like E. coli was in your well, then you'd want to shock chlorinate your well. If you do any plumbing in your system at all, you want to make sure and shock your well or your system. Little things like water meters, water softeners, new fixtures can cause coliform hits in your water system. Another reason you might want to shock your well would be if you get the pump replaced. And when that happens, you are opening up this well to contamination. Anytime you take this well cap off, there's a possibility of contamination getting in. So if you have somebody, a well driller here replacing the well, they're gonna have to pull the pipe, the drop pipe and the well pump out. And then sometimes they end up setting it on the ground or contamination ends up getting in the well. So you're gonna wanna make sure and shock chlorinate your well after that. Some things to consider when you're shock chlorinating your well. Number one, and probably most importantly, is you should warn all your consumers in your water system. So warn them that you are going to shock chlorinate. There's going to be a high amount of chlorine. They should maybe take their aerators off at some point and clean them out after the process. Chlorine is an oxidizer, so if you pour it down a steel casing, it's going to corrode the casing a little bit and pick up some metal debris. If a water source has never been chlorinated and they might have iron and manganese present, chlorine will oxidize that iron and manganese and may bring that out of solution. If you bring iron or manganese out of solution, it's going to end up, you know, in your distribution system, in your water storage tank, and in consumers' homes probably. So those are considerations that you should think about before shock chlorinating the well. So now we're going to look at some of the equipment that's needed to shock chlorinate a well. A tarp will help to keep everything from getting contaminated. Some wrenches, and these are to remove the bolts that are on the well cap. A good flashlight. Once you remove the well cap, you're going to want to look down in there and see what's going on. See if there's any leakage around the casing. See if you see any holes in the casing. NSF approved chlorine. Right now we're using 12.5%. It has the NSF sticker on it, so we know that this is made for human consumption. A measuring cup, preferably glass. Don't use any of the metal ones because chlorine is an oxidizer, so glass is preferred. You can use a piece of PVC to put down your well and use a funnel and pour your chlorine in there that way. The purpose is to get the chlorine past your pitless adapter and get the sodium hypochlorite down a little bit deeper in the well so that you don't lessen the life of that pitless adapter and may cause a leak or something in the corrosion. Pour the chlorine into a bucket of water to dilute it down a little bit, and then you're not pouring straight chlorine down in there. Another thing that you're going to need is a hose. If your well is close enough to a building where you can use a hose, after you put chlorine solution into your well, you're gonna put the hose in the well and you're gonna kind of circulate the water and stir it up. That'll help the process, and it'll be a faster process if you can do that. Some safety gear that you may use or you should use. The first thing is gonna be some eye protection, chemical proof neoprene gloves,
leather gloves for handling wires.
You're gonna have to turn off the power to your well. So they make a little device that detects electricity and detects whether the well has indeed been shut off.
Calculate the chlorine dose based on the volume of water in the well and the strength of chlorine you are using. Refer to the chlorine dosage table linked in the comments to help with this calculation. If you do not have a tool for measuring the water level in your well, you can borrow a well sounder from Vermont Rural Water Association.
All right, now we're gonna disinfect our source well.
First, shut off electricity to the well. Follow lockout tagout procedures if your system has them.
The next thing I'm going to do is remove the bolts on the well cap, or sanitary seal, some people call it. Once my bolts are out, I put them in my pocket or someplace safe. Next thing I'm going to do is pull this cap off and look at it. There's no cracks in it. It looks to be in good shape. And then I'm going to check and make sure the electricity is turned off. I'm going to take my electricity pen and I'm going to double check. And yes, it is off. It will beep if it's not. Next, I'm going to pull out my wires. And when I do that, I'm going to use leather gloves. Some wells have a lot of wire, extra wire in them. So we're just going to kind of set this off to the side a little bit, so it's not in our way. Kind of look at them. Make sure you don't see any insulation missing on them. Next step I'm going to do is look at the well and see what's going on with it. So I'm looking down in there and I can see the pitless adapter. I can't see the water level and I don't hear any water running in there or anything. It looks like it's in really good shape. Next I'm going to put some safety gear on, some goggles, and some gloves. And I'm going to mix some chlorine in the bucket. Again, if we dilute a little bit of chlorine in here, it has less impact and less corrosion on the casing and everything. So we've determined that we need 2 cups, which is a halfway point.
Now put the PVC tube down the well and place the funnel on top of the PVC tube.
For the next part, it's going to be helpful if you have an assistant to hold the tube. And again, this tube is going past the pitless adapter, so we're not putting bleach sodium hypochlorite right on the pitless adapter, which is brass, and it will corrode it and lessen the life. So we are going to now pour, and everybody has safety gear on. Now, since this well is close enough to a water source, we're going to put a hose down it and start circulating water through the system. And that'll mix up the sodium hypochlorite in the well more and give it a better shock chlorination. And it'll be a faster process if you can do that. A lot of wells are located too far away to do that, so that's understandable. That's easy enough to do. You're just going to stick it down in. And then you go turn on the water and let it run. Let's say for like a half hour, let it flush out and run. At this time, we could turn on the well and move some water, and that also helps in the whole process. If you do that, you got to be careful that when you put the wires and everything back together, that you go back and shut the breaker off to this well.
After that, place the electrical wires back inside the well and replace the well cap and bolts. Then turn the electricity back on. If you have a septic tank, don't let this chlorinated water flow down the drain. The chlorine will kill the good microbes in the septic tank. Instead, flush the water to the yard through a hose until it no longer smells of chlorine. Don't flush chlorinated waters to any waterways such as streams, ponds, or lakes. To summarize, the steps of shock chlorinating a well are to turn off the electricity, remove the well cap and wires, calculate the chlorine dose, measure it out, pour the chlorine into a bucket of water, and pour this mixture down the well using a PVC tube and funnel. Replace the electrical wires and well cap, then turn the electricity back on.